सिंस द फर्स्ट समिट इन 1961 आर मूवमेंट हैज़ रजिस्टर्ड मेनी अचीवमेंट्स टू इट्स क्रेडिट बट ऑन द इशू ऑफ ग्लोबल न्यूक्लियर डिसआर्ममेंट विच वाज identified as a priority by our leaders in 1961, we have yet to make a decisive headway. With the end of the Cold War, we are convinced that there is a window of opportunity that needs to be exploited. Many sections of the international community are now re-evaluating their earlier positions and becoming convinced of the merits of a phased approach for nuclear disarmament, which they considered too idealistic in 1988. The Canberra Commission on the Elimination of nuclear weapons declared that the opportunity now exists, perhaps without precedent of recurrence, to make a new and clear choice to enable the world to conduct its affairs without nuclear weapons. Many others are realizing that the nuclear non-proliferation treaty cannot provide a lasting and genuine solution to the problem of proliferation. It is vital for our movement at this juncture to renew our commitment to the goal of a nuclear weapon free world and take advantage of this environment. Many of us have called on the basis of the document adopted at the Canberra Summit for multilateral negotiations leading to an early conclusion of a nuclear weapons convention prohibiting the development, production, testing, development, stockpiling, transfer, threat or use of nuclear weapons and providing for their elimination. India's recent nuclear tests took place in the geopolitical environment where our security was becoming ever more threatened by the overt and covert nuclearization of our neighborhood. We do not, however, believe now any more than we ever did before that nuclear weapons are here to stay. On the contrary, if the established nuclear weapon states agree to negotiations to abolish nuclear weapons, we will be the first to join. Today I urge them, as India has urged them so many times before, to join us in the non-aligned movement in negotiating a nuclear weapons convention through which we can eliminate this last category of weapons of mass destruction. This movement, in keeping with its long standing commitment, is issuing a historic call today for safeguarding our future. Let us pledge that when we assemble at the next summit in 2001, it will be able to welcome the collective decision that nuclear weapons shall not cast their shadow into the new millennium. Apprehension has been expressed in some quarters that recent developments in South Asia raise the specter of an arms race and heightened tensions. These apprehensions are misplaced. India continues to seek good relations with all its neighbors, work with them to build on our communities and shared aspirations. Differences should be resolved in a rational manner, peacefully and through bilateral negotiations. I have had a cordial meeting with the Prime Minister of Pakistan at Colombo, and our delegations have continued the dialogue here. This is not the place to air the differences in some of our positions. The Simla Agreement, which both India and Pakistan have ratified, provides an agreed mechanism for resolving these differences amicably among ourselves. Let me say this loud and clear, there is no place for any third party involvement in this process, however well intentioned. The state of Jammu and Kashmir is and will remain an integral part of India. The real problem there is one of cross-border terrorism. The international system in which the movement must function remains beset with inequality and uncertainty. Ethnic conflict continues in Europe as well as other parts of the world. The Middle East peace process remains deadlocked. Religious fundamentalism and terrorism daily claim innocent victims in many parts of the world. Protectionism, currency speculation, and flight of capital have been set back to the economies of many developing countries. Pressures on developing countries have intensified as the new architecture of the multilateral regime in trade, investment, development, cooperation, environment, and human rights shrinks the political space available to developing countries. The United Nations is being asked to shoulder increasingly responsibilities, but its financial resources rest on shaky foundations. Expansion and reform of the Security Council should be based on global and non-discriminatory criteria. NAM and developing countries are most often the objects of the Council actions. They must have a role in decision making in the Council on the basis of equality. To meet the aspirations of its members, NAM has to develop the strength to translate its numbers into an effective voice in international affairs. It has to regain lost ground in a changed international environment. Another priority should be to set an agenda for the management of the international economy. Protectionism has returned in markets of the developed world. Trade and investment are being increasingly used to promote political objectives on labor standards, intellectual property rights, human rights, and the environment. These are defenses thrown up against the recent success of some developing countries. These members have emerged in the vanguard of international growth.